Let the song of the Lord rise among us. Let the song of the Lord rise among us. Let the joy of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Oh, 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 oh. Let it rise. Oh, 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 oh. Let
There we go.
It is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, you may be seated. Good job, kids. So, kids, would you do me a favor? Take all your pom-poms and just set them here on the altar steps for me. And then I want you to do like we do over in the kid factory. Grab some carpet. Teachers or girls in dresses or skirts, you may sit on the pews as well. But everyone else, grab some carpet and face this way. I've got a story I want to share with you today. Can I do that? I can do that with you? That'd be great. That'd be great. Well, here, oh, that's not it. That's the order service. I don't want that. I would just be telling you what's going on today. Woo! What a fun day. I'm so excited. I love this day. I love the fact that we have special stuff for children going on today as well. But I want to share with you a quick, short devotion, mostly for the boys and girls. But you never know, Mom and Dad. You may hear something new. You're like, huh, I did not know that. So hopefully we'll all pick something up here as well. But we're going to talk about Jesus. Now, kids, when you were waving the palm fronds, we were playing a video up here. Who's that supposed to be a representation of up on our screen? Does anybody know? Who, Lindy? Jesus. And this is the day when we are going to celebrate Palm Sunday. Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, and what was going on that day in Jerusalem? Well, here's a really exciting thing. As Jesus was traveling with his disciples, he said this. He said to some of his disciples, he goes, I want you to go ahead to the next town, and there you will find a donkey. And I want you to untie that donkey and bring it to us. Now listen, he told the disciples, if anybody asks you, why are you doing this, you tell them, we need it for the Lord. And so they went to the town ahead of them, and they went to go get the donkey. And as they did, there were some people milling around talking, and they suddenly noticed these strangers taking a donkey. And they went, hey, what are you doing taking the donkey? And so they said, just as the Lord had instructed, the Lord needs it, and it will come back to you as soon as he is done with it. And they said, okay. And so they took the donkey. Now I got something special to tell you about this donkey. This donkey had never been ridden by anybody. This donkey, when they're new and no one's ever ridden on them, they don't like to have someone riding on their back. How do you think that donkey acts? Do you think it acts all calm or do you think it gets kind of crazy? How many of you say crazy? Yeah? Let's find out grown-ups. Do you think crazy or calm?
Crazy.
And to make it worse, it was a boy donkey. So you know it was just filled with spit and vinegar there, right? But you know what? That wasn't the case at all, boys and girls. That donkey was as calm as could be. And when the disciples brought the donkey to Jesus, now they're not in Jerusalem yet, but the disciples began to take off their cloaks, their outer cloak they wore, like, almost like a jacket, and they laid it on the back of this donkey for Jesus to sit on. Now, did you know that a cloak that a disciple owned was probably one of their most valuable possessions? And they were giving it up and laying it down on that donkey for them. That was pretty amazing stuff. Now, as they started traveling, people in the outskirts of town started to hear rumors. I think Jesus is coming to our town. Wouldn't that be great, people, if we said, I think Jesus is coming to Grants Pass? Well, how about you get excited? How about, you know, Jesus is in Grants Pass? Someone say excited about that? Yeah. Well, they said, Jesus has come into Jerusalem. And the crowd started running out away from the city to try and see him. The reason they were so excited is this. They had heard stories that Jesus had done many miracles. In fact, he had just finished raising a dead man back to life. And they wanted to finally meet this person who was the miracle worker who could do these things. And they started running out, and the crowd was gathering around, and they were getting very, very excited. Now, as they got closer to town, there were people near Jerusalem, and they started to ask the crowd, hey, what's this big crowd? What's everybody doing? And the people started to say, Jesus, the Messiah, is coming to town. You folks, it was like royalty coming to Grants Pass. If we had someone very famous like royalty coming to Grants Pass, do you think we would decorate our town more and do some more decorations and put the red carpet out? How many of you think we would do that? Yeah, I think we would. So here's what they did. They got more excited. They're like, he's coming. So people who had their cloaks again, was that their most valuable thing a lot of them owned? They started to lay them down in the street. And they laid them down in the street for the donkey to walk on. Now, there were some people maybe who didn't have cloaks. And what they did is they got so excited. They're like, we want to do something too. So they ran out in the field. And they ran out by nearby trees, and they grabbed palm branches, and they started to cut them down. And they ran over, trying to get ahead of Jesus, because remember, it was a big crowd. And they started waving, just like you guys were doing. We were singing Hosanna, and I'll tell you why we were singing Hosanna just a minute. And they started to lay the palm branches down as well. They were making a very comfortable path for Jesus to come in on. Well, they lay their coats, but you know what? I want to share with something really interesting. In Zechariah 9:9, it said this. It says, do not be afraid, city of Zion. Here comes your king riding on a young donkey. You're like, whoa, the Bible said that. But you want to know the part that just may blow your mind? It was written 500 years before Jesus was born. And it said that he would come riding on a donkey. A king on a donkey, imagine that. Well, these people, they were so excited and they were laying all these things down. The crowds, Jesus had crowds in front of him. Jesus had crowds behind him. Jesus had crowds to the left and right of him. And they were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. And Hosanna means to save. And they were saying, this is the one who saves. They said, Savior in the highest, Hosanna. And they wanted to continue to have Jesus around to do these great miracles. That was an amazing thing. But like any story that we see, there are good guys, and then there are what? So I got to tell you about some of the bad guys that were in the story. You see, while the people were excited about Jesus coming to Jerusalem, there was another group called the Pharisees. Everyone say Pharisees. They were not excited. You see, they were used to everyone like, listen to them talk, because they thought they were pretty smart, intelligent men. And they loved the attention. You see, but Jesus, he didn't do things for attention. He did things because he was asked by his Father in heaven to do things like miracles and things like that. And so Pharisees were getting quite upset. And as they saw Jesus coming in, they were like, nobody's paying attention to us. We're important too, and no one's watching us. And so they started to yell out to Jesus as he was riding on the donkey. And they said, teacher, why don't you tell these people to stop praising you as if you were God? They were pretty mean about that, weren't they? They weren't the good guys, that's for sure. And the Pharisees thinking Jesus is getting too much attention, and they demanded. They said, Jesus, make this crowd be quiet. Make this crowd stop. And Jesus paused, and he looks at them. I love what he says right here. And he says, if this crowd, if they were quiet, even now, the rocks would literally cry out, Hosanna. Because even the rocks were under the authority of God, and they knew who created them. The earth was created by the Lord. And Jesus was simply saying, if the people stop praising me, this world is going to start praising me. The very essence of nature will start praising me. And so they were pretty upset by that whole deal. So this is telling of a story about why Jesus was coming in on Palm Sunday. So we see a king. We see the king entering on a poor donkey. Now, Jesus for this next week, so tomorrow's going to be Monday. So boys and girls, I want you to think about this. Monday through Friday, Jesus is staying in a neighborhood called Bethany. So for this next week, while Jesus is in Bethany, by the way, which means poor house, or house and poor together. So Jesus is not staying in the Ritz-Carlton. Jesus came in on a donkey. Jesus stays in a very, very poor neighborhood. Jesus was demonstrating for you and for me humility and humbleness, and that's how we are to be as well. Now imagine the first coming of Jesus, he came as humble and poor, but the second coming of Jesus declares he's coming on a white horse to take us to heaven, and that is going to be an awesome day. But this week, we are celebrating Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. That's an amazing story we should be excited about. Now, boys and girls, I want you to leave your palm fronds here, but would you stand up with me, please, if you could? That'd be great. Now, we have some great stuff going on for you in the service, and Pastor Dennis is going to tell you that in just a minute. But kids, I want you to go find your mom and your dad. They're in this room somewhere. Hopefully, they didn't leave you off and go to Starbucks on there. They're here somewhere. If you know where your mom and dad are at, go find them now where they normally sit. And if you don't know where they're at, come back down to the front. I'll be right down here in the front, and I will help you find your mom and dad, okay? Would you please help me welcome Pastor Dennis up this morning?
One girl poked the other. I know where mom and dad is. They're on their way. Welcome to Palm Sunday. Glad you're here. Today's going to be church for the ADD. And so for some of you, it's going to be like, finally, I've been bored out of my mind for months, you know. Going to get something going here. For some of the rest of you, you're going to go, that's not very holy. But that's the way it's going to happen. And it's going to be kind of like some of those events you read about in the New Testament. You got to read your Bible with imagination sometimes. So there's this story where Jesus goes to the house of one of the Pharisees, one of the people that Pastor St. John was just talking about that thought they were important. And so they go to the Pharisee's house, and they're having dinner, and it says that a woman who was a sinner, and we're not exactly sure, there's certain implications about how she might have sinned, is there, and she's weeping, and it says that her tears are falling on Jesus' feet, and then pretty soon she's wiping his feet with her hair, and nobody's saying anything. They're just sitting there eating dinner, and this is going on. Do you ever wonder, it's like, what kind of dinner is that, where that kind of stuff's going on, and nobody even brings it up? You know, I mean, the stuff that happens in the New Testament is so much more active, I think, than a lot of the things that we experience. And so today's going to be kind of New Testament. There's going to be kids moving around. There's going to be noise going on. There's going to be people going here and there. And all this stuff is happening. And it's all designed to help you to be able to worship today with a genuine sense of experience. And we want you to jump in and be a part of that. Things are going to be happening all week, and this is Holy Week, and of course starts with Palm Sunday, ends with Easter, and hopefully you're going to take advantage of some of those things. On Thursday, the seniors, Pastor Ron is going to be hosting a Passover meal. It's going to be midday on Thursday, so any of you that would like to sign up for that, are there any seats left? There's still a few seats left. Any of you that would like to sign up for that, you can come and experience a Passover meal. Like the one that Jesus had with his disciples on Friday night. Pastor Seth's going to be leading a worship time for Good Friday that's going to be a little quieter, a little more reflective, kind of unplugged. It's going to be happening down in the fellowship hall. If you haven't been down there, just out here and off that direction. And that's going to happen Friday night for Good Friday. And then next Sunday, of course, is Easter. And we've got just a ton of people getting baptized, and baptism and testimonies are going to be what Easter's about. It's a pretty cool deal. Stephen, we got, about a dozen people, I think, being baptized. My sermon's getting shorter and shorter and shorter as more people sign up. There'll be a two-minute devotion at the end of baptism, and so that's... But what better day to be baptized than on Easter? And so we're just gonna have a great week of celebration. Today is built around not only remembering the events of today and the events of this week, but it's also in keeping a little bit with what we've been studying in the book of Acts and some of the challenges that we've been receiving from that. You remember in the book of Acts, when we started in chapter 1, the first challenge, and that's really what we're doing with Acts, is we're reading the stories and saying, how does that challenge me? And that first challenge was that whole issue of waiting and praying, of having the discipline of waiting and doing the work of praying. And so today is going to be built around the celebration of communion, but it's also going to have this idea of, can we wait? Could we begin our week, this the most holy of all of the weeks of the year, could we just say, God, I'm going to give you this hour. I'm going to wait with you in this challenge to pray. Because it was during the dramatic events of this week, it would have actually been late Thursday evening into early Friday morning. It's hard to get the time frame of Jesus and his disciples. They have the meal on Thursday night. You know, in the Jewish calendar, the day begins when sun goes down, right? Some of you are aware of that. So tonight when the sun goes down, that would be the beginning of Monday. For us, it's at midnight, but for them, it's when the sun went down. And so Passover would have been celebrated by Jesus and his disciples actually on Thursday, what we would think of as Thursday evening. It would have been sundown on Thursday when they would have started the Passover meal together and then into the garden for prayer and then into the morning of Friday for the crucifixion that happened by noon. So these are kind of the events of the week, but today is going to build around this Palm Sunday event, but it's going to remember all of the things that Jesus did, and it's going to give you a chance to kind of touch and taste and move and respond. But again, built around this idea of setting aside time for prayer, because we have this incident that happens with Jesus and his disciples when he goes into the garden, and Jesus begins to pray, knowing what's coming. And he's asking his disciples if they would pray with him. So in Matthew 26, it says, Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. Do you know what the name means? There's real symbolism here. Gethsemane, it means the place of pressing. So when it talks about a garden, we think of English gardens. We think of things with little trails and paths and lovely little flowers and all the rest of it. In this case, it would have been an olive grove. That would have been the term that we would think of. They would have called it a garden. We would call it a grove, where the olive trees were, and they would collect the olives, and they would press them to get the oil out. And so this grove was named after that activity. So it was the place of pressing. That was the name of this olive grove. And so that's where they went, to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. And he took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John. He took them along with him, and he began to be sorrowful, and he began to be troubled. And he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell on his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. And then he returned to his disciples, and he found them sleeping. And he said, couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation, because the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Some of you are familiar with that phrase, didn't realize that Jesus said it or where he said it and in what context. But here are the disciples. It is late. It is late Thursday night. It is early Friday morning from our time frame. They've been celebrating this large meal together, and now Jesus is asking them to pray, and they're falling asleep. They've become distracted by the events of life, distracted by their own fatigue, distracted by a full belly at the end of a long meal. They're just distracted by stuff, and they can't stay awake and pray. So today we're going to ask you to watch and pray for an hour. We're going to ask you to do that. I want to ask you to do that in engaging in something that is a sacred remembrance when you pray. You're remembering sacred events. You're remembering the things that changed your life. You're remembering the things that changed history. We are marking the events that determine the calendar of when the years are numbered, before Christ and after. These are significant events, and for you to have a sense of sacred remembrance. We prepared communion for you so that you can offer thanks to Jesus, the one that died in your place, in payment for our sins, so you can remember all that Jesus has done for us. And included in this way are some physical ways to respond. And I want to just kind of go over that with you. So certainly we have the elements of communion that are here, and you remember that Jesus, it says, took the cup after dinner. The third cup in the Passover meal, there's four times where a cup is passed and everyone participates and drinks from that cup. The third cup is the cup that happens after dinner. It is the cup of the covenant. Jesus takes that and he says, guys, we've been remembering now for the last 1,500 years the covenant that God made with our forefathers when he brought them out of Egypt and delivered them from slavery and bondage and brought them to the promised land. He said, I want you to know that tonight we're going to change what we're remembering. That story is still true. Their bondage was physical. Human bondage is to sin. It's spiritual. God literally moved your forefathers from one place to another. I'm going to change you from one person to another. You will be born again, phrase he used with Nicodemus 3 years earlier. He says, we're going to change what this is about. In the past, we celebrated by offering the Passover lamb. I'm going to offer my body as the forgiveness for sins. So he said, tonight we're going to change what this is all about. So he's going to say, this is my body which is broken for you. Not the lamb that got your forefathers out of Egypt. This is my blood that is shed for you in the new covenant. Not that gets you from Egypt to the promised land, that gets you from sin to righteousness and redemption. He says, we're going to change how we do this. And you get to come and remember that. You get to take these elements and participate in that. There's another thing that you can do, and parents, I hope you're alert to the fact that some of the things that we're doing are especially designed so that you and your kids can kind of participate together. But one of the other things that you can do is that on this little piece of paper, there's a little tablet here on each side that you can take and write the sin that you want to confess to God, and you can put it here in the paper, or put it here in the water, and it dissolves and goes away. Because Scripture tells us that when he separates us from sin, he separates our sin as far as the east is from the west, that he puts it in a sea of forgetfulness. What a great phrase. There is no sea of forgetfulness. And even when God forgives us, we still remember. But God doesn't remember. We come and say, God, I'm so sorry, I did that again. And he's gone, what again? There is no again. I forgave you last time. I'll forgive you this time. Every time is a new opportunity to start over. So you get to come and write your sin on the paper. You get to put your paper in there and you get to have it disappear because that's what happens through grace. We want you to be able to partake of communion in those ways. In addition, we've created some places of prayer and promise, and you'll see some topics. They're up here on the stairway walls. Not that these are the only things that you can pray about. We just wanted to give you some help. You can certainly pray about whatever you would like to pray about, but we've put these out there. We've got one station designed specifically for kids, and so one of our children's workers is going to be over there that the children are comfortable with and familiar with, and so if you'd like for your kids to go there and to that station, they can be able to pray there. There's another one for healing. Over here we have for provision, and over here we also have for salvation. You'll find that when you get to each of these, there's going to be these cards in the basket. These cards have promises, scriptures that relate to the thing that you're praying about. And so if you come and pray over here for healing, we have the verse from Isaiah. I'll just read it for you. Isaiah 53, you're pretty familiar with it, I think some of you. It says, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. And so we're going to ask you during this time to take time to go and pray, find one of these places or find another place to pray, but go and pray. There will be people there that will pray with you if you would like, and you can take that little verse and you can take that promise home with you and hang on to that as a reminder of the fact that you and Jesus talked about that issue this morning, and it's your opportunity to remember in faith what God's going to do for you. Also, what's going to be available, and I noticed we got the door closed. We'll have to kick the door back open. Right over here is the prayer room area. That was good, I'll tell you what. What can I say? Some people just more spiritual than others. That's all there's. All there is to it. She started heading for that door and it just opened on its own. I know that feeling. Uh-oh, here comes Jeanette. I got something else to write on that paper now. Through the amazing open door, you can go into the prayer room. There's a whole variety of things that you can do in there. And again, today is about an opportunity for you to touch some things, to experience some things, to taste some things, to physically move and go to a place and meet Jesus in that place and take something with you from that place. It's about experience. And we want you to experience these things. I don't want you to miss them. Don't just sit in your seat and watch it happen. I want you to experience what's available for you today. When you go into the back room, there's some great places that you can go. A few weeks ago, we had another kind of prayer time, and we'd put a sheet up there where you can put your hand on the sheet and draw your hand and then put your prayer request in that. And the neat thing about that idea is that you can come along and follow those people and put your hand where their hand was and pray for the same thing that they were praying for. And you can take some time to pray for other people, but it's a way to put your prayer request up there as well and know that others will come behind you and that they'll pray for you. There's some places back here where you can draw. So you might want to just, you know, say, this is what today means to me, and you might want to draw something out. And so there's pens and crayons and different kinds of colored pencils back there, and you can draw things, and there's no grade, you know, it's a free art class, there's no grade, nobody's going to judge how well you did. As long as it's meaningful to you, you can draw that and take it with you. We also have some benches and some pillows back there that are in front of a cross, and if you'd like to take your communion elements with you and go back there and literally kneel in front of the cross and just remember what Jesus did for you, these kinds of things are available. There's also a place for you to write prayer requests and put them in the wall. There's a rock wall there that you can put your prayer requests and designate them. So we'd like for you to take advantage of that and to experience that today. I'm going to truly ask you not to experience this as though it was a commodity. The idea is not to come and say, I got my communion, I'm out of here. The idea is for you to experience sacred space and to create sacred remembrance. It's to create sacred moments. And so I'd like for you to take the communion and truly reflect on what you're remembering. Truly reflect on what Jesus did for you. Don't just come and get it and gulp it down and go. That's not the point. The point is to try to remember. And so if you want to move around and find some other places to receive communion, if you want prayer when you come for communion, people are here to pray with you. If you want to take your communion back to the back, and if you want to kneel before the cross, that's all part of what you're doing. Taking your sins and just watching them disappear in front of you and go, that's what grace is all about. I want you to participate in this event, and I want to encourage you. I want to challenge you. I want to dare you. I want to triple dog dare you to treat today like a sacred moment, and to say at the beginning of Holy Week, I will wait with Jesus before I do anything else. That the most important thing I can do is to slow down, hit pause, spend some time with Jesus, remembering who he is, remembering what he's done. And I want to encourage you to listen, because I believe that Jesus has things to say to you. Part of our remembrance is saying things to him. It's saying thank you. It's saying how much I appreciate what you did that I don't deserve. It's saying, God, it's amazing how you've changed my life and what you saved me from. But being in a sacred place and having a sacred moment is also about listening. And so there's pens available. If you didn't bring one, get out your electronic device and be ready to type in a note. But I want you to be ready to listen to Jesus and hear what he has to say to you. at the beginning of this Holy Week. It may be something very personal where he reaffirms his love for you and you hear some things. The Old Testament prophet says that Jesus sings over us with love. We try to sing to him that way, but he sings over us. What is he singing over you today? Maybe it's a familiar song, but the words are his words to you. What are you hearing from him? I want you to be ready to write that down. Be ready to share that with someone else this week. The worship team is going to be coming, and they're just going to be offering to us songs that we can use in prayer. And so I want you to take the songs that they're leading and turn them into your prayers and say, there you go, Jesus. I don't even know how to write a melody. But I'll tell you that that's a good one, and the words that that person who wrote that melody put down are words I want to say to you. So I'm going to take it, and it's not just a song. I'm going to pray what is being led. Because for right now, that says what I want to say. I want you to use the songs in those ways. So I'm going to ask some of the people that are going to help us. We've got some people that are going to come and help us with communion this morning. We have some people that are going to meet us at the prayer stations on the sides, up under the stairwells. The prayer room is yours. It's open, and it's yours to enjoy. And I want you to just find a way for you to make sacred space and create sacred moments. I want you to be able to feel free to move around. And I know, doesn't it kind of go against everything that you were taught, especially if you grew up in church? Because if you grew up in church, what was your constantly being told? To sit still and be quiet, all right? And so here we are, we're breaking all the rules. I don't want you to sit still. I want you to move all over the place. I want you to come and get communion. I want you to put your prayers and of forgiveness in the bowl of grace. I want you to go over and have somebody pray with you about healing. I want you to take your communion elements and go in the back, and I want you to kneel in front of the cross. And then I want you to go and draw a picture that you're going to hang on your refrigerator that says Holy Week on it. And you're going to so I want you to do all the things that your parents wouldn't let you do in church when you were growing up. I want you to sing with us. I want you to pray with us. I want you to make noise, and I want you to not sit still. Cool? Can we do that? And I triple dog dare you. Stay for the whole time. Please, don't treat communion like it's on sale at Walmart. Run down front, get yours, and leave. That's not what it's about today. I want you to experience Jesus in all of these things. Jesus, I want to thank you that you got here before any of us did. And you didn't get here because it was empty space and you thought you'd fill it up. You got here because you knew we were coming and you wanted to meet us, and you were so anxious to meet us that you were here first. And so, Jesus, I pray that every person in this room would find a way to express themselves to you, and that you would find a way to speak to them in a way that is personal and real. I pray that they would hear your voice. I pray that they would feel your forgiveness. I pray that they would be overwhelmed by your love. I pray, dear God, that there would be a sense of your presence and sacrifice. Thank you for this opportunity to worship. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The first people that are going to move actually are going to be the ushers. They're going to serve you, give you an opportunity to worship in giving. There's also in your bulletin an insert there. If you have prayer requests that you want our prayer team to be praying for this week, write those prayers on there and put them in the offering so that we can pray with you this week during Holy Week. Let's experience Jesus together.
Open the eyes, my heart, Lord. Check, check. Open the eyes. to shout your name, oh Lord, yeah. Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord, there is no one, there is no one like our God, we will praise you, there's no one like our God, we will would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring. Behold the man upon a cross, my guilt upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. His words have just watch and pray. Find in me not all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Thank you. Time began, you were on your throne.
We're just going to go to this, I believe.
Okay.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light.
Lord,
forever seated high. Let's sing it out. I believe in God.
Resurrection,
that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of
sing that last chorus again.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Sing it again.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Since we're all here, can you just close in the gaps? Can you close in the gaps so that you're shoulder to shoulder with somebody? Closing the gaps would mean you gotta move your feet. Moving in. Moving in. One more time. Shoulder to somebody. Let's do it again.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, God.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. Have a great celebration of Holy Week. We look forward to sharing it with you.
Your hand, it comforts me.